So when we use the evidence-based practices and the evidence-based modalities that we know about to help you unlearn these maybe hurtful things that you've been saying about yourself, we can literally change the way that you think and feel about yourself and literally change your brain, which then changes your life. Okay, hi everybody. Thanks for coming back if you've been here before or if you are new here. My name is Mickey. I am a therapist and we talk about therapy things on this channel. We are talking about something that I have had to cut out of multiple videos before because I just can't shut my mouth about it. I've gone on many tangents about it and it didn't serve our purpose to keep like a 3-minute long rant about it in an unrelated video. So we decided to just dedicate a whole video to it. Hopefully you guys are as excited to talk about it as I am. I know that this is really the high octane content that y'all came here to see. So we're talking about neuroplasticity because it's something that is incredibly interesting to me, but also because I think it is kind of a fun and hopeful topic. So we're gonna talk about it. So let's just get into it. The term neuroplasticity is a little bit of a weird one. When I first heard this, I was a little bit confused because I didn't like the inclusion of the word plastic in there. Obviously your brain is not made of plastic. Neuroplasticity refers to the brain's ability to reorganize and restructure itself, especially with the inclusion of specific stimuli. Essentially what this means is that your brain is capable of like rewiring itself. We've talked about this in a video before, that this is the subject of a lot of discourse in like the sort of pseudoscience Instagram graphic world that is very frustrating to me, but there is some truth to this. And so that this is what I mean. We had, if you watch the therapist reacts to like poor advice on the internet video, we had to like just cut it out because I just would not shut up about it. So this is why we're talking about it here. I'm looking over here, by the way, because I have notes. This is like really a lot, so I'm trying to keep it on track. Okay, so in order for us to fully understand like the scope and the majesty of neuroplasticity, it's important for us to talk about some other preliminary structures of the brain first. One of the things that I want to talk about is our brain's tendency to look for and identify patterns. Brains really love to do this. Our brain is, you know, like hardwired to do this as a survival instinct. It's actually a very useful tool. Your brain is really adept at identifying similarities between certain things and kind of like grouping them together. There's a couple of different theories in the like therapy psychology world. Jean Piaget is one of the people who coined the concept of schemas, in which your brain categorizes things into groups. And so that's kind of what we're going to talk about today. But a great example of this is like chairs. You and I can pretty easily identify a chair in most circumstances. An office chair, a recliner, a dining room chair, one of those weird yoga ball chairs. They all look like chairs to us, right? Like your brain kind of automatically makes this distinction that it's a chair. Even if the chair is upside down, even if the chair is sideways, even if I've taken a sledgehammer and smashed it into a bunch of different pieces, your brain is like, that's a chair. That's because your brain has done all of this work to categorize things into different schemas and essentially into different groups. This is very useful. One of my favorite fucking things to tell my clients is about how koalas, despite the fact that they are just absolutely the most adorable animals, they're so fucking dumb. Oh my God. Koalas, despite the fact that they're like murderous little teddy bears, are also like not the smartest. Their evolution has taken place in such a way that they literally have a smooth brain, which means that like our brains, you know, if you are familiar with like the sort of cartoony caricature of a brain, we have all the wrinkles in it. Or if you've seen an actual brain, we have like wrinkles and dimples. I forgot the actual sciencey name for them, doesn't matter. But our brains have wrinkles and dimples in them, and this increases the surface area that we have to form neurons, and it makes us smarter. Koalas don't have these, and so their cognitive ability is significantly limited. One of the experiments that's been performed is that koalas, their primary source of food is eucalyptus leaves. So koalas are used to gathering these off of a tree. So koalas, if you put them on a tree, they'll rip the eucalyptus leaves off and they'll eat them, right? But if you gather a bunch of eucalyptus leaves and you put them on a table in front of a koala and you set the koala there, the koala doesn't recognize that that's food. It doesn't understand that that's the food that it needs to exist. So if you lock this koala, I don't think they actually did this, but like in theory, if you lock this koala in a room with a table filled with eucalyptus leaves, bitch would starve to death because their smooth brain prevents them from recognizing that there's a table filled with food. so upsetting. But this is what I'm saying, like, this is why it's so fascinating that our brains have evolved in the way that they have, because you and I are able to identify that there are similarities between certain objects and, like, circumstances and people and characteristics that allow us to draw conclusions about particular things, right? Safety being chief among them, for example. So one of the things about this that, you know, so like the question then is like, why are we yamming on about koalas, right? So the thing about this that's useful in the field of mental health here is that your brain, again, is very adept at identifying patterns, but it's also good at categorizing things into groups, and it forms pretty safe assumptions about things based on, you know, its ability to categorize things. This is useful for, like, survival, because we can tell the difference between, like, you know, a safe place to be and an unsafe place to be and a chair and a car. But it's not super useful when your brain wilds out and does this with, like, hateful things that you say about yourself, for example. So if you become particularly used to this process of saying really hurtful things to yourself, your brain picks up this pattern and continues to run with this. And eventually this core belief about yourself that's formed on this very hurtful thing that you have said or was said to you can start to feel very true. Your brain becomes very accustomed to thinking in this particular way. And so this can feel very overwhelming when you're in the middle of mental illness and you're maybe depressed or you're very anxious. It feels very overwhelming to try and change the way that you think about yourself. There's a lot of hopelessness and a lot of fear that goes into, like, well, how am I supposed to unlearn these things that I think about myself and that genuinely feel true, right? This is why I think neuroplasticity is so absolutely fucking incredible, because we know from the research that we are able to physiologically sometimes change the structure of your brain using the appropriate interventions. And like I said, there's a whole bunch of research about how to use this to help people heal from strokes and TBIs and, like, a number of physiological illnesses. I'm not a medical doctor. I don't understand that. I'm certainly not a neurologist. So please don't ask me questions about that. But I did do some research into the implications of this for mental illness. And we know that cognitive restructuring and cognitive behavioral therapy in particular is one of the most reliable ways to do this. So when we use the evidence-based practices and the evidence-based modalities that we know about to help you unlearn these maybe hurtful things that you've been saying about yourself, we can literally change the way that you think and feel about yourself and literally change your brain, which then changes your life. That's incredible. From, like, an evidence-based perspective, this is incredibly hopeful about people's ability to recover and to continue to thrive from mental illness. But I think also just, like, from a human perspective, like, this is the shit that makes me feel so passionate about my job. Like, this is why I do what I do, because humans have this just incredible spirit. Like, we are wired for survival. It makes me so excited and honestly kind of makes me emotional to think about how cool it is that we are walking around in this skin suit that, like, yes, is very much flawed, but is literally wired in such a way that is designed for you to thrive and continue to exist. That's dope as fuck, and I just wanted to talk about this because I think it's very hopeful and it's very encouraging. And I know that being in the middle of treatment for mental illness can feel so overwhelming and so hopeless. And I have very much been there and I have very much helped people work through this before. But I just wanted to encourage you guys and put this out there that if you are in that place of feeling kind of hopeless and feeling like, ugh, like, I don't know how this is gonna change or how this is ever going to get better, like, I'm telling you because I have seen it happen, but I'm also telling you because I am, you know, like, have the research sitting in front of me. It is very much possible and probable that you can change your life and change your brain given the right stimuli and given the appropriate resources and help, and that healing is, like, not only a possibility, but, like, very much part of your biological structure. So yeah, that's it, I guess. I'm just very excited by science and biology and the way that our brains are structured to help us just continue to live our best lives. I think that's so cool that our bodies and our brains exist in this way where, like, not only are we structured for physical survival, but your brain is literally made in a way that is designed for you to live your best life. Like, it's not good enough for your brain to just continue to survive and, like, that be good enough. Your brain is structured in a way to help you continue to thrive. That's so cool. Ugh, that's neat. I just think that's great. And I really want to encourage you guys to, like, keep that in mind, that you, like, have, like, biology on your side. But you also probably have people on your side and science on your side. So like I said, I know it can feel very hopeless and very difficult, but you are very much not alone in that. And there is like a whole lot of hope and research and science and stuff out there. So I hope this helps a little bit. I've been like yelling for this whole video. So we're gonna go. I hope that you guys enjoyed this. If you found it interesting or useful, click the like button because that lets me know that you guys want to see more of this type of content. And subscribe to the channel while you're down there because I'd love to have you stay and see some content like this or some more of our Therapist React style content. And then share the video to help the channel grow and to help each other grow. And I will see you guys next Saturday. Okay, bye.